My name is Sally Dumisa and I'm a gang rape survivor. I had a great childhood, I would say, in the sense that I was provided for, went to really good schools, went to all girls school from primary school. Although a lot of the time I was just left with my siblings because my mom was traveling due to her work. I enjoyed doing a lot of outdoor activities. I've always been a big girl. High school was a lot different to primary. So high school, I was a lot more lenient. And when the gang rape happened, I was now sort of like I was in standard eight, kind of responsible. And then by then, my sisters weren't so uptight on me, like primary school. The person I was going with to this event was older than me. She was my sister's friend, so she was a lot older than me. So I think when I mentioned that I was going with her, the trust factor was in place. And because she didn't live far from our house, it was just assumed that I'd be back home safe and she would ensure that I'd get home safe after the event. So what generally happens in South Africa during springtime, people go out because it's after the winter. So they go out to like parks or like open areas where they could actually do a barbecue or have a braai. And this specific one was in an area called Gemiston, and there's a dam there. Imagine somebody little older than you, who is very beautiful and sexy and invites you to this braai, and you're thinking, oh my God, I'm probably worth something to be invited to something like this. I was just like, okay, for the fact that she's inviting me to this, I agreed. I agreed because I'd never gone to anything of the sort. We were the kids that would stay after school for aftercare until like 5 o'clock. So primary school, we were really occupied with a lot of school stuff. It was a Saturday. I would go to her house at about 11, just before afternoon, and we would change at her house, and then from there we would get picked up by the people that we were going with, and we were going to use a microbus, like a minivan, to go there, and we would pick up people along the way before we reached the destination, which was Germiston. The day before that, which was a Friday, I had the conversation with my sister that I'm gonna go to this thing, and she was quite okay with it. I think I told her a couple of days earlier. My mom was in Switzerland at the time. When it arrived, there were 5 other gentlemen in the kombi. I only knew 2. When I say no, I mean like in terms of seeing their faces in our area. And we got into the minibus, and it was just kind of just like chatting, everybody finding out who's like asking, how are you? I'm fine. And everything seemed pretty cool. And I think my guard was down because I was with somebody that I trusted. And then, yeah, I was poured a glass of orange juice. And then that's the last thing that I remember. One of the guys in the minibus was pouring juice. I was poured juice, but other people were sort of like drinking alcohol already prior to us getting into the minibus, that I understood, but they weren't drunk. And then the next thing I remember is just my eyes opening, and it's pitch black outside, and I can see the stars, and I can hear crickets, because that's what they sound like in the middle of the night. And the first thing that just came to my mind is, where am I? You know, you have like split seconds where you think, did I fall asleep? But it was just daylight just now. And yeah, where am I? And where's my friend? I can't definitely tell you sort of like the thoughts that came to my mind at that moment, other than where am I and what is going on? And I think from there, it was just me. I'm definitely in danger, but all of that doesn't matter. I just need to figure out how to get to safety. And for me, knowing the situation at home with my mom not being in the country and my guardian obviously unaware that I've probably gone to this thing, with my sister only knowing, the last thing I wanted was my sister to find out something had happened to me via, like, with the newspaper of me lying in the felt, because I had figured that much that I was in the felt because I felt around in the space around me, and I could feel the bush, like the grass and the dirt. And then at this point, obviously then just touching myself, and then I could feel my pants were not there. My jacket wasn't there. I wasn't wearing any shoes, but that didn't really concern me as much as I just wanted to get home. I think I just sort of had a moment where I just, like, my head hit like concrete. And I think when it hit that concrete, I was like, okay, at least even if I die, let me die where people can see me. I didn't realize that the concrete was like actual tar road. Luckily, a lady who was coming back from somewhere in the early hours of the morning, she saw me. And at that moment, I was still able, I didn't have a cell phone then, but she asked for a contact number. Luckily, my landline at home, and I recited it, and she called the landline, and my sister picked up. And then she relayed to my sister that she would be taking me to the nearest hospital closer to where we lived. Okay, so here I was, 17, in hospital, and with the last thing I could remember in my mind is drinking a glass of orange juice. And the nurses came in to check me, and I mean, they kept asking a number of questions, some which I couldn't answer because I didn't know what happened. The only thing I remember is that glass of juice that I drank. I had an injury on my head, I'd been hit in a couple of times with a rock, and I had a wound to my stomach, which I'm not sure what they used for it. I remember just like lying in the bed, and the one question I just had is, where's my friend? The police arrived. When they arrived, they took my statement and then they left. And then a couple of hours later, they came back with a detective. He then proceeded to tell me that they contacted my friend who initially I went with to find out where she was and was she aware of what happened to me. And the response they received back from her was that she was at home sleeping and she wasn't aware of what happened to me. And they asked her, why didn't you look for her if you found that she was missing? And she was like, she tried to look for me and she couldn't, and she figured I was fine. And she left. The nurse started to explain how to use PrEP. So the medication they give you immediately after rape to prevent you from falling pregnant and from getting HIV and AIDS. My sister was there with her best friend at the time, and they took me home. And I just sat there and I just cried. As much as time kept going, I kept having sort of like flashbacks. I stopped going to school. I was refusing to eat. About three days later, after the incident had happened, a phone call came into the landline at home, and my sister picked it up, and she came into my room and she said, Sally, somebody wants to speak to you. And I said, who is it? And she said, it's the girl that you went to the thing with, her mother. I picked up the phone, and in so many words, the only thing she said to me is, do not ever tell this to anybody because it's embarrassing. And at that moment, a huge part of me just kind of died. At this point, I was getting flashbacks. It's almost like I would see snippets of me waking up in between the actual gang rape and then going back into unconsciousness. And I think at that point, I just decided, you know what, my life is over. I'm an embarrassment, I'm a shame. I'm not going to talk about this to anybody, as I was told by somebody who's older than me. So I'm just going to live with this. I'm 17 going on 18. I was like heavy drinking. My sense of fear was completely dead. Eventually, I just stopped going to school. This is like standard 9. And I was also doing drugs at this point. So I found out that it was 5 guys from the investigation report. I know for like a long time, I had an issue with the color orange, and that's because when I was in the minibus, outside of the orange juice, there was somebody else in the minibus that was wearing an orange t-shirt. So it's little things, so it would be triggers that would trigger little moments from that day. Being in rehab, I think, was the start of understanding that there might be possibly a way. And I was in rehab for 6 months. So when I was there, there was a lady that I had made friends with. Her name was Mariki. And we became like really close. And she had gone through a lot of abuse and rape. I think being in rehab with her gave me perspective on my rape. And I didn't feel so damaged. And she was such an amazing person. And I think nobody ever had told her that. In the 5th month of me still thinking I'm going to get out of this and I'm going to leave here and I'm going to go back to my old life, she ran away from rehab. She absconded in the middle of the night. And a couple of days later, her family came to pick up her belongings. they had found her deceased in Hillbrow from a drug overdose. I think for me, that hit me so hard that I was like, I don't want my life to end just like that. These guys have already taken so much from me. I don't want to give them any more of me. Stayed an additional 3 months. I worked the program, did the meetings. I actually tried to work through my own trauma and left rehab. It became too painful. There was no amount of alcohol that would numb me anymore. There was no amount of drugs that would numb it anymore. I wanted to stop feeling, and the feeling of wanting to stop made me feel that I was forced. It's almost like I had no other choice but to say, you know what? Screw it. I've already felt all the pain I could possibly feel. It's not going to kill me to try this. And if this doesn't work and it hurts me, it just adds on to everything else. But I'm going to try. I went back to school. And then I heard, so remember I had mentioned that out of the guys that were in that kumbi when we were picked up, two of them, I knew their faces. It was eventually discovered who the guys were because I think they apprehended one of them, and out of guilt they mentioned. But because I wasn't willing to press charges and go to court for all of that, which was my decision, and one of the guys who was actually part of the guys who did this, her sister used to go to the same church as us. And we then heard that he had committed suicide. So two guys out of the five committed suicide, which broke my heart because I wish I had the opportunity to have told them that I forgave them. My healing journey started with me having to understand that I'd done it for so many years where I was suppressing and not feeling all those emotions and not feeling everything I had felt out of that whole experience, and it wasn't helping me. My emotions were being suppressed. I was using everything else to numb myself other than dealing and facing with what I went through. One day I quit my job and I took everything I had earned and I bought a sleeping bag and I bought a laptop and I took my first bus to a rural area in KZN, and I found a local church and I got there and I said, hi, my name is Sally. I am passionate about working with women and children. I would like to help children and women who are struggling with rape and sexual abuse. And that's how it started. So I would become the link for, and the whole purpose of doing that, I thought about, I was like, if it took me close to 15 years to get help for my gang rape, and that was because I live in the city and I have access to so much, what about a 15-year-old version of me that is in the rural area, no water, no electricity, no form of communication? And that was my point of going there. I never started it with the intention other than to find other versions of me and help them work through their issues a lot quicker. It doesn't have to take you 15 years to get help for being sexually abused and molested or raped. I share my story because it was through sharing my story and bits and pieces of me with other people that helped me share my story. As much as my gang rape story might seem different to so many people, but all our stories are pretty much the same. The trauma might not be the same, but I know that there's so many other people who've gone through sexual assault or rape and might never have the voice. As for the lady that I went to the barbecue with, a couple of years after the incident, I was in varsity. I sent her a lengthy email just asking her to give me closure as to what happened that day. And why has she never come back to me to apologize? And she responded to the email with, I will set up a lunch date and we'll meet and talk. But we never did. But I made peace. Thank you so much for listening to my story. I share my story because I know that even if it reaches one person, it's important just to know that you're not alone and there is life and hope after sexual assault or rape.